In this video, we will discuss the termination step of eukaryotic translation. Specifically, we will discuss the termination factors and focus on one special factor in much more detail. And as we discuss the mechanism of termination, we will contrast the process of eukaryotic termination with the process of prokaryotic translation termination. The major difference that we will see in the eukaryotic termination is that it does not include a translocation step, and we will see why that is the case. And ribosome recycling in eukaryotes is also very different from the prokaryotes, and we will discuss that as well. The link to the prokaryotic termination video is down in the description if you need a refresher. And hopefully you understand the prokaryotic translation because it'll make this video very easy to understand. So we begin where we left off in the elongation video, where the ATS ribosome complex has the tRNA attached at the P site. And this tRNA is attached to the polypeptide chain, which is protruding into the protein exit channel. In this ATS ribosome complex, the E site and the A site are both empty or unoccupied. You can check out the eukaryotic translation elongation video if you're not unsure how this ATS ribosome complex is formed. The link to that video is also down in the description. So the termination starts when a stop codon is encountered at the A site. As we have seen this before, there are three stop codons, UAA, UAG, and UGA. And this ATS ribosome complex, where the stop codon is sitting at the A site, is called the pre-termination complex. Before we dive into the process of termination, let's talk about the key players of the mechanism, which are the termination factors. In prokaryotes, we saw that there are two class 1 termination factors, RF1 and RF2, and one class 2 factor, which is named RF3. And this helps in the proper functioning of class 1 factors. The class 1 factors have the job of recognizing stop codons. And then we also saw ribosome recycling factor, and the elongation factor G, which enables a translocation step in the termination of ribosome, and this leads to the ribosome disassembly. On the other hand, if we talk about eukaryotes, we have one release factor, which is called ERF1, and this factor alone recognizes all three stop codons. And similar to prokaryotes, where RF3 helps the class 1 factors, the eukaryotic RF3 also helps the RF1. And this RF3 is also a GTPase. And we will see that the RF3 helps in the polypeptide release and the positioning of the release factor 1 at the peptidyl transferase reaction center at the P site. Then finally, we have a protein complex named ABCE1, which simply stands for ATP binding cassette E complex 1. Sometimes people also call this guy RLI, which stands for RNase L inhibitor. These names are not that important, except to keep in mind that the ABCE1 generates energy for the ATS ribosome splitting. And this happens when the ABCE1 interacts with ERF1. And after the ATS ribosome is split into subunits, we will see how initiation factors 2D, 1A, and others help in removing the tRNA and the mRNA from the 4DS subunit. There are two potential pathways for this last step, and we will talk about both of them when we get there. The main player in this entire termination process is the release factor 1. And let's just look at the structure of this release factor, which will make it easier to understand the entire mechanism because release factor 1 sticks around until the end of the termination process. So this release factor sort of looks like a fidget spinner. It has the N-terminal region, which loops out another middle region, and then it finally has a C-terminal end. The C-terminal end is called domain C, where C stands for the C-terminal. The N-terminal is called domain N, where N stands for N-terminal. And this looped out middle part is called domain M, where the M stands for middle. The middle domain has the GGQ motif that we have already discussed in the prokaryotic termination as well, and this has the job of cleaving the polypeptide from the P-site tRNA. Domain N has the peptide anticodon, which we also talked about in prokaryotic termination. But in this domain N, the motifs responsible for stop codon recognition are different from prokaryotes. They are TSK and TASNiKs, and some others. But it's this TASNiKs that you need to keep in mind. The domain C has a bunch of binding sites that are responsible for binding to release factor 3 and the ABCE1 complex. Just one last thing to contrast here. The TASNiKs motif is very different from the stop codon recognition motifs in prokaryotes, where we saw PVT, PAT, SPF, and SPV motif. Alright, so this fidget spinner looking like release factor essentially mimics the tRNA structure. And because it can recognize the stop codons, it is brought into this pre-termination complex to bind the stop codon at the A site. But release factor 1 usually comes in a complex with its enhancer protein, which is the release factor 3, which also happens to be a GTPase, so it carries a GTP with itself. The release factor 3 binds at the C domain of the release factor 1, but the catch here is that the domain M, which has the GGQ motif, is actually bent towards the release factor 3. There are some secondary structures like switch elements and loops in release factors that help in the bending of the domain M. And this ternary complex of release factors is ready to bind at the stop codon in the ATS pre-termination ribosome complex. Let's just quickly sketch out the structure here. And let's, for simplicity, just say that the stop codon here is UAA, and it is present at the A site. The ternary complex is then positioned in such a way that the domain N of the ERF1 contacts and essentially recognizes the stop codon. The release factor 3 then positions itself near the junction of the 40S and the 60S subunits. And part of it also touches the factor binding region. So for now, in this complex, the domain N is positioned where it should be, but the domain M, which has this GGQ motif, is sort of away from the tRNA on the P site, and this distance is about 80 angstroms. So the GGQ motif cannot cleave the polypeptide just yet. So after this ternary complex is bound, the SRL region in the factor binding region activates the GTPase of release factor 3, which releases the phosphate bond. Now this termination factor bound ribosome moves to the next step. So following this bond breaking, the release factor 1 is properly accommodated by the release factor 3. This simply means that the release factor 1 pairing with the stop codon becomes irreversible. So it is now difficult for the release factor 1 to dissociate away from the A site. And additionally, as a result of this GTP reaction, the domain M now is moved into the peptidyl transferase reaction center at the P site. And now it is very closely sitting to the tRNA. And this makes it attack the 3' end of the transfer RNA. Mechanistically speaking, the GGQ motif increases the ester bond accessibility for a nucleophilic attack. And when this nucleophilic attack happens, the polypeptide is released from the ribosome, which is later folded into a functional protein. And when this happens, the RF3 GDP complex is also released. The exact mechanism for this release of release factor 3 is unclear, but it's partly because the GDP complex makes the release factor 3 unstable on the ribosome. And now we can sketch out the resulting ADS ribosome. And you notice that the P-site tRNA has no polypeptide attached to it, which means that the protein exit channel is free. And because the release factor 3 is gone, the release factor 1 is alone at the A site, still paired with the stop codon. And this ATS ribosome complex, where polypeptide is released from the ribosome, is called the post-termination complex. And because there is no polypeptide at the tRNA here, the translation process, or protein synthesis, technically speaking, is finished at this step. So, which means the only thing that is left to do for a cell now is to split the ATS ribosome into subunits. And now we enter the process of ribosome recycling. To start the recycling process, the complex ABCE1, also known as RLI, enters. And this complex has this hinge element, which is essentially a helix loop helix structure. Another thing to note about the ABCE1 are these two pockets, which have the potential to close, but they're open for now. So this ABCE1 complex is recruited onto this post-termination complex. Specifically, the hinge element interacts with release factor 1 at the domain C, just like release factor 3, and binds at the junction of 40S and 60S subunits. And this ABCE1 complex has these pockets in an open form, and these pockets close when ATP is bound. But when ATP is not bound, they are open. So we call this ABCE1 configuration an open configuration. And now this ribosome is ready to move to the next step. So let's just draw out the ribosome structure. And the transition happens when two ATP molecules bind in the pocket of the ABCE1. And when they bind, it closes the ABCE1 complex. And this complex is referred to as the closed configuration of ABCE1. This closed state of ABCE1 then triggers a feedback loop, which goes through ERF1, and this causes the ABCE1 to break the phosphate bond present in the ATP. And this phosphate cleavage releases energy, and this release of energy from ATP is used to split the ATS ribosome into 60S and 40S subunits. Essentially, the hinge element acts like a can opener and splits the ATS ribosome, which means that the 60S subunit is released, and this causes the release factor 1 to be kicked out as well, because it is attached with the ABCE1. And this ATP reaction causes the ABCE1 complex to go back to its open complex state. But after this subunit splitting, the 40S subunit is still attached to the tRNA and the mRNA. But both E and A sites are now empty. So we somehow need to release the transfer RNA and the messenger RNA from the 40S subunit. There are two mechanisms to dissociate the 40S subunit. The first mechanism involves initiation factors 3, 1, and 1A, which remove the P-site tRNA. And we have seen these guys before in the initiation video. The initiation factor 1 binds the transition of E and P-site, and the initiation factor 1A binds the A-site. And this kicks out the tRNA from the P-site. So now the P-site is empty. And then the EIF3, which is this giant initiation factor, helps in the release of mRNA from the 40S subunit, specifically by interacting through its subunit J, which binds at the mRNA entry channel. This exact complex where the 40S subunit is attached with these initiation factor is a complex that we also saw in the initiation step of the translation as well. So I hope that the translation process is now coming to a full circle of understanding. So that's one way of recycling the 40S subunit. The other mechanism relies on a different initiation factor 2D, which binds at the P site of the 40S subunit. And this destabilizes the codon-anticodon pairing of the mRNA and tRNA, which is happening at the P site. And as a result, it causes the mRNA and tRNA to release. And this 40S subunit is now recycled. Or it could be turned over. Or it can go into another round of translation. One last note. This initiation factor 2D sometimes is also known as ligatin. So if you see this term being used instead of IF2D, don't be confused, they refer to the same factor. So this wraps up our discussion on translation termination in eukaryotes.